And this book has not got software in the title, because it's actually not about software. Because we discovered that the world has gotten bigger than software, especially when you start taking a look at the way the change in the whole attitude towards doing technology, what with the smartphones and the apps and the platforms and those concepts. So we call this book The Lean Mindset. And it has five chapters, so it's 45 minutes, pretty short time to do five chapters. The first chapter is about great companies, and the second about energized workers, and about delighted customers and genuine efficiency, not just plain old, and breakthrough innovation. And obviously, I can't talk about all of those in this time frame. So what I thought I would do is talk about what I think is the backbone of all of these things, because what company doesn't want all those things, yeah? What company doesn't want to be great and have energized workers and delighted customers and really true efficiency that lasts and breakthrough innovation? So I think the core is having energized workers to begin with. So I will talk about where do they come from. Maybe a few examples too. So let's start when our workers are young. Kids, okay? So think about Canada, not too far from here, but even closer to my home in Minnesota. Elite hockey players in Canada probably were born in the first part of the year. In fact, if you look at the statistics in any elite group of hockey players in Canada, 40% were born between in the first 3 months, 30% in the next 3 months, 20% in the next 3 months, and only 10% in the last 3 months of the year. So why would that be? Oh, and by the way, it's not just hockey. If you go to Europe and look at football, that thing we call soccer, but really, it's generally known around the world as football, the same phenomena. So what's this about birthdays? Anybody? Yeah? This one here, Outliers? Or other research. So the reason is that the cutoff date is January 1st or December 31st for kids that are, well, how old when you start hockey in Canada? Or football in Europe? Little, okay? And the age cutoff date means that the kids that are getting onto the really young elite teams are the kids that are some months older than their counterparts. So if there's a big difference between a six-year-old who's been six for the whole year and a six-year-old who's only just turned six, but they both get on the same team, and who does better? And who gets the better coaching? And who gets the more opportunities? It becomes pretty clear when you look at the statistics what happens when kids don't get put into a pool and get treated the same, irregardless of their age. It's not native ability. It's pretty much age. So that's interesting. Now let's go 6 years older than that, okay? I've heard a lot of things in the Agile world about how come we don't have more women in computer science, or less in science in general. And an interesting work was done on that. It's a book. And it's a book called Why Aren't There, it's kind of fine print here, but it's Why Aren't There More Women in Science? And it was a bunch of edited research articles on why there are not more women in science. So this is not just speculation. This is various scientists saying, here's the experiments we've done. And the most interesting one is called Is Math a Gift? Math, and it's about beliefs that put females at risk. So now we're 10 years old. And what happens is Carol Dweck and her colleagues gave 10-year-olds some confusing tasks. Because as you hit junior high, your math and science things get to be more confusing than they used to be. It wasn't just arithmetic anymore, and 9 times 9 is, you know, that's you memorize. It's you have to start thinking and figuring things out. So you have to puzzle through things and start learning more. And girls, interestingly enough, the higher their IQ, the worse they did with confusing problems. In fact, by this age, girls have higher grades than boys in general across the board. And then as they get to these confusing problems in the research, if they're really smart, they don't do really very well at all. And boys, the higher their IQ, the more they learned. So that's an interesting phenomenon. Why? By age 15, the math and science grades of the smartest girls in the US have fallen well below the grades of boys, the ones who had the highest IQ and the highest grades up until then. So there's something going on there, just like in hockey, where we're leaving a whole bunch of folks behind. And another finding was that teenage girls often lose their confidence and their effectiveness when they run into difficulty, and teenage boys usually do not. So how come? Well, there's this concept of how girls are raised, typically in the culture, and that is they get a lot of praise and not very much challenge. And when they hit their first challenge, they think, I'm not good at this. So maybe I'll go do something else that I am good at. They're so used to being good at something. So it's sort of like, if it's hard, then I'm not good at it, and I'll go do something else. That's not as true for boys, who get less praise and more challenge as they're young. And so when they hit challenge, they're used to the concept of, I just have to work at it to get good at it. So Carol Dweck talks about two mindsets. The first mindset is a fixed mindset. It says talent is fixed. And a lot of people, even though it seems, well, obviously we know talent is not fixed, they grow up with, I'm used to being good. If I have to work, guess what? Then I'm not good at it. So you're born with it, and you're either good at something or you aren't. Whereas the growth mindset says that skills can be learned and improved. And there used to be an argument about this. There certainly isn't anymore. But still, there's a lot of cultural things that tell people that. The fixed mindset says avoid challenges. Don't do anything that might make you look bad. In fact, Carol Dweck, the researcher behind this, when she was a kid, was offered to be in a spelling bee because she was really good in spelling. Yeah, well, she didn't want to be in a spelling bee. Why didn't she want to be in a spelling bee? Was because she thought she might not look so good. She might not win it. And she didn't want to be challenged to the point where she might come in second. And those who have to work hard, you know, they're probably the ones that aren't so good at something in the first place. Whereas the growth mindset welcomes challenges and finds that failure is a learning opportunity. So what they did with the junior high school girls and boys is they gave them two different sets of sort of preparation for going into junior high. One was teaching them that when something is hard, it's not you. It's because everything's always hard to begin with, and you just have to practice, and you get better. And the others got, you know, some other thing, but didn't contain that little element. And it turns out when the girls got that message before they headed into junior high, they did just as well as the boys, statistically. So girls need this message. People need the message that you can get better at something. You don't always start out good at something. So the kinds of things that reward early for just being good, we saw hockey and football and math. When they get challenging, the people who have a growth mindset, who have a fixed mindset, will fall off the scale. What is some sort of sport that doesn't do that to kids? Well, I think one of the sports is martial arts. Because interestingly enough, you're not competing in martial arts. You're trying to get to the next level in martial arts instead. And getting to the next level, it doesn't matter who's with you. My daughter and my granddaughter took Taekwondo together, to all their exercises together. My actually granddaughter got to black belt before my daughter because my daughter tore a thing in her knee. But they're not competing against each other. Everybody is trying to get to the next belt level. And if you look at a fair promotion system, it's the same thing. It's not competing. It's trying to get to the next level. So there's a lot of thinking about what kind of people do we want to have that are going to be energized? And people that are going to be energized have a mindset that says, if it's hard and I work hard, we can make it work. There's a huge power behind this concept of challenge, of having something that's difficult. And a lot of work in this area was done by Csikszentmihalyi, but let me talk about his term. He calls this thing, remember when you're deeply engaged in something, when distractions disappear, time evaporates. I have another granddaughter who's a rock climber, okay? indoor rock climbing. I don't know why, but that's what she does. And she loves it. She says when she's in the wall, everything disappears but the next hold. There's no height, there's no nothing but the next hold. So that's called flow. And you get in the state of flow when you're really deeply engaged and energized by something. And so you can say his first name, but Mike is what most people call him. Chick Set Me High, started the whole concept of psychology being for positive rather than negative. It used to be that psychology was all about making sick people better. And then they discovered that it's a very different thing to make sick people not sick and to make healthy people happy. And so he started the concept, the whole psychology of positive emotions rather than negative emotions with his book. And one of the things he says is challenge is really important. And it has to be challenged matched to the skills of the people. So as people are low skilled, they get low challenges. And then as they get better and better, if you keep in the flow channel, you're challenged, but you're not over-challenged. And the trick for energizing people is to keep them in the flow channel, keep them where they have a challenge, but not one that's beyond them and not one that's too simple. So he says, the best moments in people's lives usually occur when a person's body or mind is stretched to its limits in a voluntary effort to accomplish something both difficult and worthwhile. So think about that. That's where energized people sit. They are in a flow channel or close to it. And they see it during the day when they go into their work. And if you want energized people, you are looking for people that have a challenge. So the challenge has to be there and has to be something presented to people that gets them interested and excited in their work. So let's talk a little bit more about expertise. There's all kinds of research, and some of the first research done was by a guy named Anders Ericsson. He's from Stockholm. He now is in Florida. And he did all the work on this thing called deliberate practice. So if you think about expertise, musicians, athletes, even software developers, even doctors doing diagnoses, you get good by doing what he calls deliberate practice. And it takes years of that. 10 years or 10,000 hours, which is 10 years at about 3 hours a day. And to do that, you've got to identify skills that need improvement, get a teacher or a coach to give you a lesson, practice repeatedly, obtain immediate feedback, and adjust. You can see this in sports, in athletes all the time. You can see this when you watch the Olympics, and a diver just does a beautiful, like 9.5 or however they score that, to almost perfect dive. And goes and talks to her coach. And does the coach say, great? Nope. Coach says, and here's the one thing you did wrong. And they practice intensely, perhaps 3 hours a day. So what we need is a coach, a challenge, some feedback, okay? Which means that the people have to be willing to not be successful all the time, and progress. You have to make progress. The other research says steady progress is one of the most important motivators there are for people doing knowledge work. So thinking of those, I'm going to switch gears a little bit. I only get like a few different gears to go into, but I'm going to go into a gear and talk about this concept of the fact that we have two different ways of looking at the world. Now we're sort of grown up. We're trying to become experts in something. And we have two minds. There's lots of ways of talking about the two minds, like there's our emotional side and our rational side or whatever, lots of different ways. So the name of System 1 and System 2 have been sort of labeled a sort of a generic way to talk about our two different minds. So we have System 1, surfing, just sort of responding to the moment, and System 2, thinking, being careful and pensive. So according to Daniel Kahneman, a Nobel laureate who did a lot of great work with Amos Tversky, and he has a really interesting book called Thinking Fast and Slow. It's a hard book to wade your way through, but not too bad of a book to think about. So anyway, in Thinking Fast and Slow, he talks about we have a reflexive, something's hot and we move our hand back. It's like muscle memory, it's instant, versus deliberate. Or we can be responsive, or we can be rational. You know, one side of us wants rational. One side of us wants intuition. The other side, oh, let's do some analysis. There's habit. And then there's, no, let's get some evidence. So expertise, interestingly enough, sits in system one. When you're expert at something, you automatically know how to behave. And when you do, when you're thinking, that's where deliberate practice is coming in. You're deliberately thinking about what you need to do to improve. Tacit knowledge sits over there I just kind of know that this is right. This is the way to do stuff. I can't tell you exactly why. It's inside of me. I can't write it down. Versus explicit knowledge, stuff I can communicate by perhaps writing it down. So I think of system one as our autopilot mode, okay? And I think of system two as our manual mode. And one of the interesting things Kahneman says is most of our decisions are made in our system one mode. We make almost all of our decisions instinctively, not explicitly. And system two checks up on system one. Takes a look at system one and says, how are you coming along? By the way, according to Kahneman, if system one wants to do something, then system two actually doesn't get a vote. So Chip and Dan Heath talk about the metaphor, I don't think they invented it, of our emotions are like an elephant and our rational mind is the rider on top of the elephant. And the elephant will go wherever the rider directs it to go, unless it decides to go somewhere else. In which case, there's nothing the rider can do about it. So that's the emotions versus the system one versus system two. And system two, by the way, is basically lazy. So basically, we try to make all of our decisions instinctively. So let's think about this. What does this mean in our world? We have this paradox of trying to be perfect. We saw a little bit of it where we were looking for, I don't want to need to be any better. I want to be perfect. But if you take a look at our SLAs, for example, we have this idea, for instance, that a center, computer center, ought to be 5.9s or even better. That's perfect or pretty close. It's also expensive. And it's as good as you can get. But there were some folks that discovered that when you go to scale, like let's take Amazon, you actually, doesn't matter how many nines you have, the little bit that's going to fail is going to kill you because it's still going to have, if you're going billions upon billions of transactions every moment, you will fail. And maybe being perfect isn't really what you want. Maybe being able to recover when you fail is better. So there was a firefighter, worked at Amazon in the operations area. And he suggested to the management that perhaps one of the things that they ought to do is learn how to become good at recovering when something goes wrong. Just the way firefighters practice fighting fires. A lot of work in this whole area, this area of expertise, is in the book Streetlights and Shadows by Gary Klein. Wonderful book. Easier to read, by the way, than Thinking Fast and Slow. So Gary Klein is big on expertise and really good at saying, how do true experts that are really good in their field get it? And they get it by the kind of practice that they have here. So what happens at Amazon, for example, is they have something called game day. Game day is when you go inject a fault, pull a plug. And I mean a serious plug. It's going to take 3 or 4 days, a boatload of people, to recover from that. Now, they've been warned that something's going to happen, and that's it. And they do this regularly. Now, not too many senior managers have enough guts to say, yeah, let's pull a plug on a regular basis and see what happens. But the thing is that the people in the centers, first of all those little things you think are working but only get tested during a disaster, you find out which ones actually aren't quite working anyway, and you get people used to the procedures that they have to go through to recover from the inevitable failure. So it's maybe not being perfect. It's maybe learning to be resilient that's even more important. So what they do this at Google, they do this at Amazon, at any really large-scale place. They practice. They use their system to mind to develop the expertise they need when something comes along, and they have to deal with it in system one, in automatic mode. So maybe it's more about becoming good at something than it is being good at something. So let's then, okay, let's do a case study because this is one of my favorites and I thought you'd really enjoy this guy. We've been working with a group in Intel. There's another really good company, amazing company. One of the things about Intel is that they have challenged themselves for decades to keep up with Moore's Law. So it's like, this is the very first picture that Gordon Moore did, and it shows on the vertical axis relative manufacturing cost per component, and on the horizontal axis number of components per integrated circuit. So to put it simply, the number of stuff that they can put on a given area of silicon is supposed to, and for the same cost, is supposed to double every 2 years and has been for a very long time. And the threat has always been we're at the end of Moore's Law, but I've been hearing that for a decade. And I'm sure the time will come, but they still just keep going on, so it's kind of amazing. So there's a very challenging environment, and people at Intel say, you know, you can be really good, you can be a hero, and that lasts till the end of the 2 year cycle. Because you have to be heroes, and then you have to start all over again the next 2 years. So it's not the we're great, it's the constant challenge that the people at Intel find really exciting. And that drives challenge across all areas of the company. For example, well, let's just take a look at this. This is from the Intel website, and when they did the 1970, the Intel 404, it was like fitting 2,300 people into a big theater in Europe. Today, you could take the entire population of China and put it into that theater. That's the kind of density increase that they've had. And they've done it 2 years at a time. So the concept is, let's double our output every 2 years. And every single department that is involved in these chips is involved in this challenge. Now, let's take PDE, the department we know pretty well, which is Product Development Engineering. And what they do, if you take a look at this, this is the overall development cycle of a silicon chip. And where you see development, that's the last couple of years. So there's some pre-work and planning in a section called development. Now, right at the end of development, you can see a circle here, you finally get actual silicon. Up until there, then it's all drawings and, you know, sketches and computer models and all that sort of stuff. And now it's silicon. And then you see the PRQ, that's Product Readiness Qualification. Now, what PDE does, Product Development Engineering, is they're responsible for that part. They get the silicon, and they're responsible for writing the tests that will test that the silicon is good. And those tests then will become the manufacturing tests that test the silicon as it's manufactured. So they develop the manufacturing test, but the first thing they do is they get the silicon. And when they get it, neither the silicon nor their tests are perfect. And they have 6 months to get the test working and to get the silicon chip into manufacturing. And they do this every 2 years. So they get 18 months to get ready, and they get, you know, 6 months to make it work. And even then, they're discovering all sorts of stuff. So that's their area. Now, the interesting thing about this is their timeline that is of interest is not 1 2-year cycle. It's 3 2-year cycle and counting, because at Intel, you do 3 2-year cycles and count. And the first 2-year cycle was in 2007 and 2008, because before 2007, they were just plain running out of, they were burning people out. They were working days and nights and weekends, and then silicon hit, and then it got totally crazy. So Patrick Eller said, we decided that we had to stop burning out engineers, because after 2 years, the engineers would say, whew, we made it. Now what's next? Oh, you get to do it all over again. Oh, no, we don't. Okay, so they would leave. So he said we had to find a sustainable pace. So they used classic Scrum. It was taught to them by a really cool guy, ex-Marine, who's a wonderful, wonderful guy that we know. And they took the classic Scrum, and then they modified a little bit because they're really working in an embedded software environment. 18 months to develop software, you marry it to the hardware after 18 months, and then you debit. So they worked in that environment, and one of the things that it gave them, the most important thing that it gave them, was a sustainable pace because they were able to understand their capacity to push back with their every two-week iteration, to push back on management and say, we can do this, we can't do that, what do you want? And so they developed a way to talk about capacity which allowed them to have the right capacity. Their boss at the time, Tim Gallagher, said that to him, the most important thing he ever wanted out of life was to be able to go into a management meeting and say, my group has the capacity to do this, but not that. And he finally had a handle on that by having these two-week iterations which showed how much work could be done. And so they got very good, but of course this is Intel, and now it's 2 years later, and now they have to get twice as good. So what were they going to do? So the next thing they decided to do was advanced Agile. And in this era, they did stuff like, I can remember I was there, and they did a value stream map. And they had six or so teams, and they were doing a two-week iteration, maybe four of them, and then they would integrate. And I said to Patrick, so why do you wait till after four iterations to integrate? And he said, well, you know, we wouldn't want to waste testing time testing too early, would we? And I said, wrong. No, I didn't say anything. I just looked at him, and he looked at me, and he said, that was the wrong answer, wasn't it? I said, yeah, that was the wrong answer. You want to test as early as you possibly can. So that's one thing they did. The other thing that they did was they went to the manufacturing plant, and they discovered that, we did a value stream map, and the transition time from when they were done with software to when time the manufacturing plant accepted it and used it was a couple of months. I said, wow, that's a long time, you know, in a six-month cycle. He said, yeah, but I said, you should look at that. And he said, no. We have a world-class manufacturing facility. That will never be any faster. I said, well, whatever you say, but I'm just saying that's a long time. So what they did was they went in and they did this value stream map thing in the manufacturing plant. And they discovered that 2 months, there was only 3 days where they were actually doing the validation testing. All the rest was waiting for silicon, getting on the schedule, all of that sort of stuff. So now we're coming up to the end of this, you know, towards 2010. And Tim Gallagher, the senior guy, is in a meeting with Intel executives. And guess what? They were late. Has that ever happened to you? They said, we need 8 weeks. Where are we going to get it? And Tim said, I can get you 30 days. Okay, now imagine the response. Whoa, 30 days, where is that going to come from? He says, all you got to do is get me whatever silicon I want when I need it, and I'll get you 30 days. And they said, sold. So he went to the manufacturing director and says, say, so here's the deal. I get you all the silicon you want whenever you want it, and you do this in 3 days because that's what that's what everybody agrees it takes. And the manufacturing director said, sure, that's a good idea. That would be a classic thing you would do in manufacturing because really world-class manufacturing organizations always want to have pre-qualified vendors. And now they were trying to get to be pre-qualified, so they took and got all the silicon they wanted, and they established that they could give them defect-free software. So when they gave manufacturing software, it was already completely validated and they didn't find any defects, and now they could do the final validation in 3 days. So that chip, these guys were heroes. I mean, they had cut an entire month off of the development of a chip that was late coming into the market. Really, really great heroes. Of course, it only lasted a few weeks because then we went in to the next two-year cycle. And the next two-year cycle was, okay, now you guys are really super and really great, now we have to do something else. So the interesting thing is these guys were so good at software development by this time, Agile didn't have any tricks left for them. They'd already exhausted all of them. So they went to something else. Let me show you what they had to do. If you take a look, I think I can draw on this if I get my pen up. I want a pen. Okay, and then if you take a look at, I have a pen here somewhere. So right up in here, we have the previous generations, and you can see that they had like three products to test, and each one took about 3 months. So over the 6 month period, they might be testing two at the same time, right? Now they've got designers who are saying, oh, there's more stuff out there in the market we got to deal with. So now they're going to come up with 9 different products that they have to be tested. That means at any given point in time, they're going to have 6 different products under test. So that's like triple the productivity, and they got, the good news is, 18 months to do it. So how are they going to do that? Well, the first thing they did was they created working groups of the people doing the development. This is a fairly large group of maybe 500. And they formed like 10 working groups with 8 or so people on each team. So a subset of the folks were put into working groups, and they were going to design their own process. And they thought being told that they had to triple their productivity would be demotivating, but it was exactly the opposite. We get to change our own processes? That's cool. What a challenge. So then they had a very good leader who basically said, we can't deal with triple productivity. That is way too vague of a goal. So they took every single one of these 9 products and they broke it down into all of the different levels of tests that they had to do. And they said, we need 5 times as many of these tests and no more of these tests. And they just laid out what they would, if that was the case, the details of what they would have to do. Then each team took one of those areas and tried to figure out how to make that work. And they used something called lean product development. One of the companies that talks a lot about this is Targeted Convergence. And this is classic. I mean, the guy that wrote the book on it is Michael Kennedy, and he used to head up the Silicon area of Texas Instruments. So the idea is that you start out with a lot of ideas, and then you converge on a solution. And you converge under a time schedule that matches what you do. But you don't start with one idea and toss it out. You start with several ideas and make it work. And you do this across all of the small things. So when they were halfway through this process of finding these solutions, Patrick went through and looked and said, you know, what we're missing is the dependencies between all these teams. So he found double the number of projects to add so that they had everything in place to create a concept of exactly how they, what process they were going to use to triple their productivity. And you do this in stages where you do it and you get some feasibility and then you prove feasibility of your new ideas. So just for example, what they decided that they were going to do was they were going to pre-qualify their software by buying their own robot and putting it and testing it on the silicon themselves instead of having the manufacturing folks do that. And in order to do that, they bought this robot and they had from Targeted Convergence, Michael Kennedy's son Brian was their coach. And their goal was that every 2 weeks, over a 48-hour weekend, the software was going to be validated by putting 55,000 chips into a socket and running software. And that's validated. That meant it could go into manufacturing. Now, in order to get that, you had to have defect-free software coming in. They were already pretty good at that, but they needed to get this robot working. And so during the feasibility stage, which was about 6 months into the 18 months, Brian came and they said, oh yeah, this robot can do the trick. See, here's the specs. And Brian says, have you tested it? Tested it? And Patrick told me, oh, we're software guys. What if it works on paper? It works on, I'm thinking, I did hardware software, and I'm thinking, he's got to be nuts. So Brian says, well, just test it. So they took 1,500 parts. That's not very many. They took it out to the robot and decided to try it. And how far do you think they got? Well, they actually got to 80 before the robot, you know, gave up the ghost. So it took them 12 months to just no big things, lots of little tweaking, to get this robot to reliably and repeatedly do 55,000 over a 48-hour period. And but they had 12 months because they found out way early that it was not going to work. So the concept of getting a plan and then showing the feasibility of it in detail so that they created this process. I'll show you the process. It's really kind of interesting. Let's see if I still have, no, I guess I have to get my pointer back. Pointer options. Pen, there we go. All right, so what happens is they have 2 teams. They have what I'm gonna call a platform team and an app team. Their platform team devises the test infrastructure, and they do work in 2-week. That's not a pen. Oh, sure enough, it is. There's an eraser. Boy, this has a delay. Okay, anyway, they work in 2-week iterations. And then they test it over the weekend. And if there's anything wrong, they have a little time to fix it right here. And then after they've fixed it, usually they don't have to, but they might have to a couple days, then it drops to the module teams. This would be the app teams. So what they're going to do is create little tiny tests for a piece of silicon. And a module is a test module. And these guys have only a week because they found that you could get problems as you assembled modules from the infrastructure. And so you had to run a test, and then you really needed a week to fix it, because by the time it got to here, they needed to have full-scale robot, and they couldn't have any defects. So the module team would work for a week, then they'd run tests, and then they would fix it, and then it would go to the robot. So the way it actually looks this way is here's the infrastructure team, and they're doing 2-week drops, one right after the next. And here's the module team, and they're working, and they're doing a test, and then they're fixing, and then full validation. Do modules, test, full validation. So they're doing also 2-week iterations, actually a week of putting it together and a week of getting it to work solid. And then here's the test team, and they're working on weekends. So the test team comes in, and on this weekend they do the integration test and the module test, and the next weekend they do the robot test. And the next weekend they do the integration module test, next weekend they do the robot test. Now, you've never seen a process like this. This is what they devised so that they could constantly drive validated software into the manufacturing plant at an absolute constant flow right from the beginning. And is it working? Yes. They turns out that 9 products wasn't the right number. They actually had more when they got there, so they're still, you know, stretched more than they like to be in the last 6 months. But they were so ready for silicon when it came, more ready than they'd ever been. And if they hadn't had this process, they would not have any shot of getting that chip out. So that's the kind of challenge that really gets people energized. And if you can create something that is a real interesting challenge for them, as opposed to something that's easy, you're much more likely to have energized workers. So I just want to close with 4 steps to a great product team. Because I like to think about product teams, not software teams. Whole product teams. Anymore, when we have platforms and apps, we're either thinking about how do I create a great platform or how do I do great apps. And apps are products. I went to a bank, I've been to several banks in the last year. This seems to be the year of the banks for Agile. And they're doing mobile apps, of course, for banks, right? But they're doing them as if they were enterprise apps. And so one of them said, boy, you know, the problem with Google is that they put in a new operating system and then we have to modify our app every few months. And I'm thinking, yeah. So what's so strange about that? But this is a novel concept in an enterprise app. So they have to stay connected with their customers over time. They can't just like do something and walk away. So looking at a great product team, I'm going to talk about the team that rescued 33 miners from the mine in Chile in 2010. Because there's an awful lot of interesting lessons, and there's a wonderful article in the recent Harvard Business Review about how this was able to be pulled off. Because now we're talking about life and death, and when you look at matters of life and death, you actually tend to get either crazy behavior or really good behavior. And in this case, you've got really good behavior. Thing to learn from. The first thing was this was absolutely a meaningful challenge. First of all, it was a matter of life and death, and second of all, there were constraints. The mine collapsed on August 5th, and if the miners survived, then there was a refuge room. They knew where it was, and they knew that it had enough food for 10 people for 2 days and water for a month, and they knew that there were more like 30 or so. So there was a matter of real constraints and a need for urgency. And when the newly elected president went to the site, he decided that the mining company was incapable, things were in chaos and was incapable of doing it. So he said, I'm going to take over. And then he called in the chief, the most experienced mining engineer in the country, who was running the biggest government mine that there was, and said, you're in charge. Now, that was a really bold move, because politically it was probably very dangerous, but he didn't care about politics. He wanted to, if there were people alive, he wanted to find them out. And so he put in charge the best mining engineer in the country, who then handpicked from his mining company 32 of the best leaders that he of the best managers that he had to pull this thing off. Okay, so they didn't go in with like just let the mind do whatever it wants to do. They went in and said, right now we have to get the best experts in the company and in the country, and we have to put them in charge. The next thing that they did was they learned fast. Typically, you drill all day, and then you pull the drill out. What they had to do was learn how to locate the drills that were going down accurately. So they had two phases. The first phase was to reach the refuge and see if anybody was there. And the second phase would be worry about rescuing them if we find them. And so as they were doing this drilling, they were looking for any and all ideas, and they tried tons of different things. But somebody came up with a little tiny GPS locator that would go down on the tip. Okay, and then they pulled it up, they could pull up and find out where the thing went. And once that was proven as a far superior technology, all of the drills started using this little tiny GPS locator, which was very novel, but it worked fine. It worked really well because they had a lot of trouble drilling straight. They knew where the refuge was approximately, but getting the drills to that was the trick. And lots and lots of experiments. And similarly, when it came time to get the miners out, because they discovered them, you can see, and there they were, and now they could feed them through the hole for a while, and in fact, it was for 53 days or 52 days. How are we going to get them out? It was not, there was no agreement. So what do you do when things really have to work? You try three options. You don't just try one and let it fail. You try three. The one that's guaranteed, the one that's really novel, and the one that you hope will work and is the best. And that's the way it worked. When the plan B, the middle plan, the one that they thought was going to be the best, got there, the other two, the really solid one that for sure would work, was only a third of the way there, and the other one was two-thirds of the way there. So they tried three different kinds of things, and that's a very classic hardware engineering thing. When stuff can't fail and you're time-constrained, don't go with one option, go with several. And the last thing you need to really energize people is steady progress. You can't just be learning. You have to be getting somewhere. You have to go towards the end. So what you're looking for is to realize that people are energized by working on teams that are successful. When I worked at 3M, we had like Google's 20% time. We had 15% time. And anybody could attract people to work on their team in their 15% time. And the thing you had to do to attract people to work in their 15% time was to be heading up something that people thought was going to be a success. The only way to attract volunteers was to get something that looked like it would be a success. And then really excited, energized people came and swarmed on the ones that they thought would be a successful. So steady progress towards success. So with that, that's kind of as much time as I have for today. I think I'll be around for the day, and you know, and there's open space this afternoon, so any questions will probably have to wait till then. Thank you.